Welcome back to another episode of What's Up, Prof. Hello, Walter.
Hi, Martin.
We are doing some news articles again.
I see your titles are getting shorter and shorter.
One of these days it's going to be a two-letter word or
something. It's going to be an essay.
Oh, you're actually sarcastic with me.
Yes. Absolutely.
Well, the reason why I did it like this is so that we can know what it's all about.
Yes, and it's also good for the internet. Then they know what the buzzwords are.
Correct.
Okay.
But before we get into this, we have to ask the Lord for help that we can put this together the way He wants it.
Okay.
Our Heavenly Father, thank You for being there for us every day and every time that we can just lift up our heads and make everything known to You. We ask that You enlighten us with the Holy Spirit and that You guide us through this discussion. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You know, Martin, the Bible says it's a time such as never was. Now, I'm an old goat, but if you had told me 5 years ago, even 5 years ago, that this and this and this and this would all happen in the next 5 years, I would have said, you know, maybe 20, 30, 40, but not five.
Most of the things looks like we're living in a movie.
Yes, we are in a movie. Mm-hmm. We are in a movie. Now, I'm so glad that we have this thing called time. Because sooner or later, it's going to run out, right?
I can't wait for the day where we don't have to have a watch anymore.
We had a talk the other day at Sabbath school. And the question was, what is time? Mm. And there are scientists that say that, you know, it's a figment of the imagination. Mm-hmm. And others say you cannot define it. And I thought about it a little bit, and I thought, what is time? You know, if it's so hard to define, what is it? And I've come to the conclusion that it is an interpolation. Mm-hmm. In German, you would say ein Einschub.
Okay.
Something that has been shoved in.
Uh-huh. That's it.
Something that has been shoved in. Shoved into what? Shoved into eternity.
Yes.
So you had this dimension of eternity, and then you had this interpolation, this Einschub, this shove in, this wedge called time. So in other words, God created time, and then he created the planet with moon and stars and sun to set times and seasons. Obviously, there must be a purpose why there should be time, why there should be this interpolation. Mm-hmm. And obviously, the only solution to that is it's to deal with the sin question.
Exactly.
You can't have a sin question in eternity because that would be eternal misery. So you have to have an Einschub. You have to have an interpolation. You have to say, okay, I'm going to interrupt eternity with a thing called time. Mm-hmm. And then I'll write a book about it. This is the book, Martin. And I'm going to tell you exactly what's going to happen in this interpolation.
In this time.
In this time slot. And if you don't believe me, then check after the event has taken place. Because God says, see, I tell you ahead of time so that when it does happen, you will believe. And then he tells you what it's going to be like. Mm. And he tells you in Matthew what it's going to be like. And then he tells you in Daniel ahead of time what the political situation and the religious situation is going to be. And then he tells you in the book of Revelation exactly what is going to happen. And then people will still not believe.
No.
So what's the point? But thank God, not all.
It is for those that will believe.
Okay. So there will be a seed of Abraham that will have faith and will believe. Because after all, he told you ahead of time. But some of the things he tells you ahead of time are so improbable that you think they will not happen.
That's the thing.
But here they're happening.
And it's happening. And a lot of people don't like to hear that we're almost at the end of time.
I cannot wait. I'm so glad. The longer your titles get, Martin, the better it is for us.
It's going to be, like you said, essays pretty soon.
Okay.
And you know what's the sad part? This is, I couldn't even fit everything in here.
What? All right. So basically, the longer the title gets, the more prophetic fulfillment we have.
It's all linked to prophetic fulfillment.
Okay. So this is what we're all talking about. So a time of trouble such as never was. So and if it was never like that before, it must be pretty bad. Mm. In other words, everything that is practiced everywhere all over the world, I'm talking about the evil one, he's going to throw the book at us.
Yep.
He's got his book of notes, and that's more than an essay long, and he's going to throw it at the world.
I think he's busy. We can see it and feel it.
And we're not even talking about some of the issues, right? So you've titled it cyber attacks, grid failures, climate, religion, gender war, and religious upheaval. And again, these are just events.
That's it. Don't and get sucked into one of these.
Exactly. These are just events. Look at the events. But always bear in mind, where's it heading? Mm. And the greater the events and the more cumulative they become, the more likely it is that people will shout, enough already, let's get a solution. And the solution is peace at last, and then you have destruction.
Chaos.
That's basically it. Why should we continue and show all this stuff?
No, we can let it play and we can leave.
Okay. All right. See you next time. All right. Let's have a look at what they're saying. New York Post, 400,000 gallons of radioactive water leaked from Minnesota nuclear plant. At least 400,000 gallons of radioactive water leaked from a Minnesota nuclear power plant in November, but officials only publicly revealed the spill on Thursday. So they're keeping a lot of this stuff hush.
It's amazing. That's why I put in a few of these. Usually, it will be all over the news when something like this happens. But now, there's more and more things happening that are disturbing, but it isn't brought to the attention of the people.
All right, here's a thought, Martin. The spirit of prophecy says that calamities will increase. Mm. There will be fires. There will be storms. There will be collisions and calamities on the great lines of travel. Ships will go down, trains will crash, aeroplanes. She never spoke about those, but the great lines of travel include aeroplanes, will crash. And, you know, technology has come to a point where none of this should actually happen. It should be so organized that trains should never collide. Mm. I mean, they have sensors to tell you when a train gets a wobble, they should be able to brake and stop and all of these things. But then, if that system breaks down or you have a cyber attack, couldn't you have calamities like you have never imagined could happen?
Absolutely. It will be a very, very dark day when all of that happens.
Yes, and recently when they shut down all flights in the United States because there was a hiccup in the system. Imagine if that hiccup takes place while everything's in the air.
Mm-hmm. Well,
could be interesting, right?
There's a lot of things that can cause huge problems, and it's very probable that it can happen.
Okay, and then humanity thinks, all right, we'll solve the problem with AI, and AI will keep everything on the level, and then AI goes rogue. And then you really have a calamity.
Exactly.
So it could become a very interesting age such as never was.
You know what? And I'll just say it bluntly. I think this is upon us. It's not in the far distant future anymore.
All right. Now, what if some of it is even fake just to create fear?
I think a lot of it will be fake. But unfortunately,
some of it will be real.
And it still doesn't matter. because the outcome will be the same.
All right. Now, whether it is the devil doing it or whether it is the destroying angel that does it, the outcome is the same.
Same.
All right. So we have these calamities. So while the energy company reported the leak of water containing tritium to state and federal authorities, and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission last fall, state officials said they waited to tell the public until they had more information. How much information do you want before you warn people that they are exposed to radioactivity?
Yeah, that's why I think it can be put another way. They'd rather wanted to keep silent to see if it can go away.
Hmm. So they had to decide what to do with this contaminated groundwater, how much leaked into the ground, before sharing the information. And then, Martin, you had this terrible train smash. Now, I know it's been reported on a lot, and people have spoken about it. And the interesting thing is that the very events that took place are pretty disastrous, number one.
Yeah.
But almost like biblical prophecy, they were foretold in Jesuit theater.
And the thing is, what happened here is it seems that there's no urgency to do the cleanup or to get people to safety.
It seems as though almost like they want a calamity?
That's the same with the previous slide of the nuclear waste. It's almost as if they want calamity to start happening.
Okay. All right, let's have a look at the news and then we'll look at some other interesting information.
The train derailed on February 3rd at 8:54 p.m. It was carrying 20 cars of hazardous materials, including vinyl chloride, a highly flammable toxic gas that causes central nervous system problems and has been linked to a host of cancers.
You have not evacuated. Please leave the area.
In the days after the accident, Norfolk Southern worried the vinyl chloride could explode, so they did a controlled burn, potentially releasing phosgene, a gas used as a chemical warfare agent in World War I. Videos soon spread widely from residents who were afraid and unsure of what they'd been exposed to.
It still smells like a chlorine and leaves like a bad taste in your throat.
Many reported rashes, sore throats, nausea, headaches, and respiratory problems, as well as seeing sick animals and water covered in a chemical sheen.
There's no way that's safe.
They're calling it the airborne toxic event.
We won't come this way.
Will we have to leave our home?
Of course not.
How do you know?
I just know.
Okay, what if it's dangerous?
Evacuate all places of residence.
That white noise movie is fascinating, isn't it?
Can you believe how similar even the footage is?
Absolutely. Now, what's fascinating, Martin, is those chemicals, I mean, they are chemicals that were used in chemical warfare,
yes,
right? And they're being transported by mega corporations and companies that own these things,
mm-hmm,
that have their fingers in virtually every pie that you can imagine. And when you look at the way in which they reacted and how casual the government official was,
exactly,
let's not say too much about him, except that he had strange shoes on. And this is very interesting. And that there are movies, and these companies are all affiliated and associated with the Vatican.
Deeply.
Deeply.
And we'll, in a later video, show also how they... This same company or companies have got their fingers in the Ukraine situation.
Yes, absolutely. This is so fascinating. So it could just be an accident, but it was foretold with such accuracy that one is interested. And just the connections, who owns what,
yeah,
and how it was done, is interesting to say that. Let's just leave it there.
Let's leave it there. But I was just thinking, you know, what did you start off with? telling us that time, God showed us in the Bible ahead of time what's going to happen. Now, isn't it interesting that maybe the adversary is trying to do the same, but through movies?
Yes, because that's his mouthpiece. He doesn't have a word. He doesn't have
that's
one.
That's his mouthpiece, yes.
Yes. So the movies, the Jesuit theater, is his mouthpiece. Now, Martin, if you jump from an accident in the United States of America and you jump to our part of the world, which is as far away as you can possibly get, then we are expecting food and water shortages. Now, what's interesting is that it's not on our news. It comes from the United States that is warning its citizens in the country. So I think let's go and do a campaign in Namibia just for a little while.
Yeah.
Okay. The United States government has warned its citizens in South Africa to stockpile 3 days' worth of supplies, including non-perishable food, 3 liters of drinking water per day, and medicine and first aid supplies. In addition to stockpiling food and water, the embassy offered the following guidance: have a communications plan for when there is no or limited power, cell phone, battery, additional charging cords. How are we going to get what's a prof out when all this crashes? We leave that to God, right?
Exactly.
All right. Ensure that you have the necessary medicines, memorize family members' phone numbers, identify safe areas, store flashlights, batteries, etc. And this comes from the U.S. Embassy. Isn't that interesting? And this comes from the embassy. So the embassy advisory comes after the U.S. government told businesses and financial institutions operating in South Africa to start thinking about a total grid collapse. Well, Martin, we are expecting a total grid collapse in this country. And I'm always surprised when I read overseas a tornado went through and, you know, 100,000 people were without power. That's world news.
And down for how long?
Yeah. In our country, the whole country is without power.
Exactly. And every day.
And if you take Zimbabwe, it's half the day every day that they are without power. You cannot run an industry like that.
No, we're off half a day.
Yes.
At this stage.
Yes.
We're in stage 4, 6 again.
Yes. So we can expect great excitement. And how many promises were made that it will never happen?
Well, many promises.
Many promises. And then in the UK, there's a rationing of vegetable, and it's about normalization.
So now they bring in what?
Climate change. Climate change. You know, we've had too many things, Martin. We have to hone down. It's not a bad concept, really, to hone down. Why should they said at one stage, they said, why should you have so many choices of cheeses when 2 or 3 would be quite adequate?
Well, that sounds a little bit Marxist to me.
The past few days have seen certain fruits and vegetables rationed by major UK supermarkets: Aldi, Morrison's, Tesco, Sainsbury's, all of these. I think we've showed this before, but just to show that it's as a result of pandemics, breakdown of supply routes, farming infrastructure, not enough fertilizer, and it's just ration.
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing is now they want to give Brexit also the blame.
Yes, why not blame Brexit? But the other side of the Brexit divide is firmly set on blaming any shortage on the weather. So it's climate change or political change. Which one is it, Martin? Or is it both?
Planning.
Or is it planned?
I think it's planned.
Okay, so the real reason there are shortages, supposing there are real shortages, you see, even they are skeptical here. Not just psyop nonsense like the toilet paper fiasco at the beginning of the pandemic, is that one way or another, they have been engineered. So, Martin, this is not a conspiracy. This is just an observation.
That's a good good point.
And then we have World War II style rationing of food fuel needed to combat climate change, academics claim in new paper. This is Fox News from this year. So, Martin, are they preparing humanity for something?
Yeah,
conditioning? Isn't this called conditioning?
Definitely. And then afterwards, there comes coercion.
All right. And it's researchers at the University of Leeds. So these are peer-reviewed articles that tell you that these things are going to happen. A top British institution wrote in the journal Ethics. Now, I don't need a peer-reviewed article to tell me that there will be famines.
No, I can have a...
I can just read Matthew 24 and it'll tell me that. And I don't have to wait for confirmation from a peer-reviewed article.
There's a difference.
Uh-huh.
That one gives the wrong blame. They want to give a blame to something else.
Ah, okay. The Bible talks about a total decay of moral values, and they talk about climate change. So the problem, of course, is policy and environment, that rationing has been wrongfully neglected as a policy option for mitigating climate change, arguing such an approach would be more effective than the slow, inequitable result from tax hike to promote a green agenda. So, Martin, are they pressed for time to bring it in rapidly?
Yes.
There's no time to hike the taxes and make people tighten the belt. Let's just bring in World War II rationing.
Finished. And I think the thing is they've tried it for so... It's not going as quick as they wanted to. That's why it's going to this.
So let's go that way. So Martin, what vehicle could be used to accelerate things?
Cyber attacks.
Aha. Let's have a look.
Hello and welcome. Let's take a look at our top story this hour. The UK organisations experienced an average of 788 weekly cyber attacks across 2022. This marks a 77% increase from the year 2021. Now, the new figures reveal the growing concerns of cyber threats. The increase in cyber attacks is largely driven by sophisticated ransomware gangs. Stock trading in London was plunged into chaos after reports of a Russia-backed ransomware gang attacking a company that plays a key role in Britain's financial system. Lockbit, the group behind the cyber attack against Royal Mail last month, targeted trading software provider Ion Group on Tuesday. The London-based company plays an integral role in the plumbing that underpins the trading of shares, debt and derivatives in the Square Mile. Ion said that 42 clients have been affected by the attack as it faced disruption in its clear derivatives division. The attack comes just weeks after Lockbit forced Royal Mail to suspend international postage deliveries. Now, this left more than 500,000 parcels and letters stuck in limbo. Earlier, on the 11th of January, The Guardian confirmed that it was hit by a ransomware attack and that the personal data of UK staff members had been accessed in the incident. Now, these are not standalone incidents. Rather, these vindicate the precarious condition of cybersecurity in businesses across the United Kingdom. According to a UK government report published last year, almost every one in three businesses in the UK are experiencing data breaches or cyber attacks at least once a week. Now, this constitutes 31% of all businesses, and over a quarter of charities are suffering. The report shows that cyber attacks are becoming more frequent, with organizations reporting more breaches over the last 12 months.
This is from National Review. For the second time in a few weeks, listen to this, a federal law enforcement agency suffered a serious cyber attack, and the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services warned that Russian-linked ransomware group called Klopp had reportedly taken responsibility for the mass attack on more than 130 organizations, including the healthcare industry. Ransomware attacks are now common as rainstorms. In a busy news cycle, you might not have heard, but two federal law enforcement agencies have had serious cyber attacks this last month.
The government system that sends messages to pilots, called NOTAM, had gone down. And then the emergency backup system had also gone down. Now, the FAA claimed it first noticed this on Tuesday night. When the problem could not be fixed, the government issued a ground stop the next morning. That's what Pete Buttigieg said. He described the culprit here as, quote, a damaged database file with no evidence of a cyber attack. So to repeat, said Pete Buttigieg, there was no evidence of a cyber attack. And then the next day, last Thursday, we noticed that virtually the same thing happened in Canada. Well, that was very strange, because the U.S. and Canada have separate aviation authorities. They're different countries, and each country uses its own software to route their planes. The systems are not linked to each other. And then we remembered that on New Year's Day, 2 weeks ago, something similar happened in the Philippines. Its air traffic control system also went down. For a time, no aircraft were allowed in Philippine airspace. Thousands of flights over Asia had to be rerouted. In the summer of 2020, UCSF Medical School paid more than $1 million in Bitcoin, and they paid it in order to get access to their own computers, which had been frozen by hackers. They were held up for ransom. Since the nationwide ground stop last Thursday, the price of Bitcoin has shot up about 20%. Is that a coincidence?
Well, Martin, that's all very interesting. Now, the idea, of course, of Tucker here is that the Bitcoin shot up because it was used to pay ransoms. Mm-hmm. It's a currency of choice for those that require ransoms. It's a very interesting time that we are living in, but how many companies? One in three?
One in three every day. The statistics is actually scary because these type of things can lead to what we've heard the whole time speaking about, grid failures.
All of these things.
All of these
now,
things.
Didn't Klaus Schwab say that this was going to happen?
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be prepared. You have a lot of little ones, and then you can have a big one. So be prepared. All right. And we spoke in the beginning about the adversary's medium.
Mm-hmm.
To warn people and to desensitize them and to inform them. And this film icon, Dennis Quaid, has captivated audiences with this kind of thing. It's interesting that in this video it says, great balls of fire. Does that remind you of a vision in the spirit of prophecy?
Yes, of Nashville.
Nashville. And pillar after pillar was struck and all of these interesting things. And, of course, that perfect replica of the Parthenon that is there consists of many pillars, and they put in that statue. We spoke about all of those things. But Hollywood is always a step ahead.
Yeah, now so they again desensitizing you or getting you ready for what is probably about to come.
Yes, and Simpsons and all of those are the prophetic mouthpieces of what is being planned while the two adversaries sit at the same table.
Mm-hmm. But Dennis Quaid's now done something that nobody's ever been able to do. Scare the heck out of Jesse Waters. Quaid has a new documentary out, Grid Down, Power Up, which explores the frightening possibility of our energy's grid going down.
Heat, gas for our cars, transportation for food restocking. All of it relies to some extent on electricity. But no one likes to focus on what could happen if it all suddenly is taken away.
A nuclear explosion in the atmosphere above the United States could unleash a burst of invisible electrical energy that within a fraction of a second could wash over this country and overload all of our most sensitive electronic devices, including the nation's power grid.
Just 30 days without electricity, it would take us back to 1880, and you wouldn't be able to get gas, you wouldn't be able to get food, You know, the police would stay home, take care of their own families.
There are plans for hurricanes. There are plans for snowstorms. There are plans for earthquakes. There is no plan for a cyber attack that would be infinitely longer in duration and more widespread than any of those natural disasters.
This is something that if it does happen, it's going to make the COVID look like a kid's show.
Wow.
Well, Martin, that's nothing new. Yeah. Our other prophet, Klaus Schwab, already said that.
Isn't it interesting that they have the same rhetoric?
The same story. It's just part of the scenario.
Now, the scary thing is, this probably can happen.
Yes. Let's say it probably will happen.
I think so. So let's have a look in South Africa.
Well, that's why in South Africa they sent out a letter, all the insurance companies, to their clients. You received one, yes. And I received one. Let's just show what it says. It says important information regarding your cover. The instability of South Africa's power supply, especially in recent times, has become a major concern across all sectors, including the insurance industry. It has become clear that the risk of a potential grid failure can no longer be ignored. One of the core principles of insurance is that the insured event should involve some amount of uncertainty. Grid failure can now no longer be considered uncertain or entirely unforeseeable. And this, combined with the consideration that such as the insurance market, has prompted us to reinforce and clarify the cover provided for losses resulting from grid failure in its policy terms and conditions.
Yes, so basically what also happened, if you read it further in the document, they're not going to cover any loss for grid failure.
And that's from the 1st of April. Yeah. So we're right there now, Martin. We're not covered anymore for grid failure. And, you know, with us, it's apparently, let's just say apparently, infrastructure collapse. Mm. But overseas, a cyber attack will do it as well.
So, once again, however it happens, the outcome is the same.
The outcome is exactly the same. Well, here's an interesting one by King David Studio. And I understand this gentleman is an Adventist.
That's what I've heard.
Well, let's see what he has to say.
The catastrophe that we speak of is total darkness.
Yes.
Is total darkness a possibility?
Absolutely.
In South Africa?
It's imminent.
It's not even a possibility. It's
imminent. Yeah, it's imminent. Listen.
But it's equally avoidable, obviously.
100% yeah. It's avoidable.
But at the rate this train is going, it doesn't look like we're going to avoid it.
Yeah, I mean, right now, the analogy I would give is that we are all passengers in a brakeless bus that is driven by the board of Eskom, the management, the government. But we are going towards a cliff. That's a problem.
Can we confidently in this conversation say we are probably in our lifetime, you and I, going to experience total darkness
this
at
year.
Some point? You're saying this year?
Yes.
Not even in our lifetime?
No, this year.
What is total darkness in your definition?
Nothing works.
Nothing at all?
Nothing. You can't transact. The banking system is down. The telecommunication system is down. Banking is telecommunication, by the way.
Mm.
So the telecommunication system is completely down. The water, reticulation, is completely gone.
Yeah.
Fuel, transportation by pipeline is completely gone. Gas, transportation, sewer, treatment and sewer, you know, removal completely stops. You can't bury, you have to bury the people if they die on that day.
You have to bury them immediately.
Yes, immediately. Because then there is no backup. There is no fuel. No one can move anywhere. There's no food you can buy.
The processing of food is gone.
The farmer hasn't got anything. The losses of all the fresh produce that currently is in any one place, within a matter of 2 days, all of it is gone fraught.
Mm.
And you're talking about the meat industry, which is the key source of protein for many people, whether talking about chicken, beef, or anything else, everything else. Hospitals. There is no hospital you can go to. There's no healthcare you can be able to access.
Hmm.
There is no Even the president will not have fuel for the helicopter to run anywhere.
Now, Martin, these were people in the know. These are not just any people. And he paints a pretty bleak picture, and he foresees that it could happen this year already. And it sounds like a time such as never was. Imagine you take a modern society and you, in a day, dump it into the Middle Ages.
Yeah.
That is pretty chaotic.
You know, there's many people that don't know how it feels to be able to walk to a door and there's a light switch next to it and you just put it on. There's many people that don't know how it feels not to have that privilege.
Yes. Well, we have been warned that a time such as this would come, and we have been told, get out of the cities because that's where the chaos will be the greatest, because there's no way of growing food and receiving supplies in those circumstances. So, you know, the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, they have warned us, and we had better take heed. Now, there are circumstances like we are going to do a camp meeting in another country. What if you're trapped there? Well, that's God's problem then.
That's God's problem, yes.
But let us be found doing our work when the Lord comes. And let us have faith. And let us act on his warnings. Because here we have a promise, even from the dark side, that these things will happen. How much more so should we heed what comes from the light side?
That's so true. We've got, like we've mentioned, Hollywood, the prophet of the enemy, telling us this is going to happen. And we had God, the true prophet, telling us.
Now, Martin, what is very important that we should understand it, when you study the prophecies in the Bible, they're linked to disobedience and moral decline. When you look at the reasons that the enemy gives, they're totally different.
Yeah.
In fact, sin becomes so paramount and so invasive, but it's never the fault of sin. It's always the fault of climate or some action or something of that nature. So here we have a very interesting double take, Martin. The Catholic Church is very involved in pushing the narrative of climate change. But here you had a cardinal, George Pell, who was not so convinced and actually spoke out against it. And you know, Martin, when someone has a voice which goes against the Roman Catholic narrative, it's always interesting to watch what happens to them.
Yeah.
Look at the news, and are they still active today? Have they been removed from society? Was it natural? Wasn't it natural? Were there accusations? You know, I don't believe anything anymore, no. Basically, that comes out of the media. You have to read between the lines.
Yeah, and you have to weigh up. It's like reading the Bible. If you take it out of context, you get something totally different.
So let's see what he had to say. He saw climate science as a dangerous religious dogma. In the end, his hardline stance held the church back. The late Cardinal George Pell left a legacy of climate science denial, which in his later years became ever more distanced from reality and the position of the Catholic Church. For decades, in newspaper columns and speeches, Pell popularized climate denial talking points to dismiss the science of global heating and to brand environmentalists as hysterical and in the grip of pseudo-religion. Well, that voice is gone.
And the
narrative continues.
Yeah, and it's interesting how they downplay, how they make him, he's actually distant from reality. The news agencies always, if you are on this, they want to link it. If you are climate change denier, they want to link it to a mental problem.
Yes, then you are mentally diseased. And obviously, if you are on the same bandwagon, even if you have zero education in a particular direction, then you receive an honorary doctorate like Greta Thunberg. So we've gone from the sublime to the ridiculous.
That's it, but not in anything. In theology.
Yes, exactly. Why theology? What's climate change got to do with theology? That's the interesting link.
It's a pseudo-religion, like Pell said, actually.
Yes, he was quite right. So the Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg is awarded an honorary doctorate from the theology faculty of the University of Helsinki. And the reason why she receives the award is that she has given us all a task that extends beyond our everyday choices through her action, the faculty explains. Now, Martin, this is so ludicrous that one wonders whether the people that decide these things are still in charge of all their faculties.
Yeah, well put. You see, I know it is ludicrous, but we've got a problem, like we've always said. This is reality. These people are making policies according to this.
Now, interesting, Martin. Even if you are selling a lie, if you shout enough and carry on enough, there are, it seems like the majority goes with the lie.
They follow suit.
They just follow suit. So, well, let's leave it at that. I really don't think we should actually read on, but you think we should, right?
Just a little bit more.
All right, let's read on a little bit more, just to get riled up. It is not about the combination of faith and climate, but about the link between Thunberg's climate activism and science. As faculty, we agree with the fundamental goals she propagates. At the same time, climate activism connects to theology in some sense. Nissenen, who is an expert in Old Testament studies, adds, "The earth is God's creation and we care for it." There are already some texts in the Old Testament, for example, in the prophets, that deal with climate change. Many things have changed since the Bible was written, but much is the same. Humans are the same, God is the same, the earth is the same, only the concerns are more severe. It is not the first time Thunberg has received an honorary doctorate. The Belgian University of Bergen awarded her in 2019. So she is accumulating them.
Can now, you believe it?
Yes, but this is very interesting. So the Bible is all about climate change.
See where they... Now, this links on to where we will go next. The gender problem is also... What do they do with the Bible here in the climate thing?
Yes.
Turns it
upside down. And let's turn the gender thing upside down as well. And humans have always been the same. Humans are the same. So there's no decline. Everything is the same. Everything has been. This is uniformitarianism. They should all become geologists and not theologists.
Yeah, that will probably work.
Now, seeing that Greta is such a authority on the issue at the latest Davos, she was asked a few questions. So let's have a look how serious she was, right?
Yes.
Greta, how many times did you rehearse your arrest at the German coal mine?
So the police starts to bring the first persons to the identity check.
Wie sieht's denn aus mit der Badstraße?
It's very likely that the German police and RWE, a fossil fuel company, would stage an arrest.
How many times were you arrested? Because you posed for several times, didn't you?
Sure.
If you want to end fossil fuels, how did you get to Davos today?
I came yesterday. I didn't come today.
How did you travel here?
Civil trains.
Civil trains or planes?
I took a private jet, of course.
Took a private jet?
Yes.
I mean, you laugh about this, but surely if it's such a big issue, it's surely no laughing matter. I mean, this is an opportunity for you to try and get people who don't agree with your message to try and see it from your side of the view and to maybe change their ways, surely?
Yeah, I wish I could tell that to myself sometimes, to take things more seriously, but you know, I'm just a young person, I tend to laugh at most things.
All right, seeing that she got a theological degree, we now have confirmation by the theologians that climate change is a theology, that it is a faith.
That's it.
They have confirmed it for us very kindly. And let's see how far this is going when it comes to other sectors like the United States and Joe Biden's ideas. Do we have a redefining of sin?
Yes.
Which one of the Ten Commandments deals exactly with climate change?
Not one of them.
Oh, all right. So if that was the definition of sin in the Bible, we need a new one. And we saw that they wrote them on tables of stone.
Exactly.
So obviously they do think that the climate issues are the new sins. And the Pope is fully behind it. But then he's always been behind changing the law. That's his forte. He's very involved in that.
It's interesting, like you mentioned now, so Greta and the theology honorary degree that she's just received, or doctorate, and this proves that this is actually a religion. So any this religion has to have rules.
All religions have rules. Let's have a look.
That's what climate change is about. It is literally, not figuratively, a clear and present danger. The health of our citizens and our communities is literally at stake. The UN's leading international climate scientists call the latest climate report nothing less than, quote, code red for humanity. Let me say it again, code red for humanity. They're making the largest investment ever, $2.3 billion. To help communities across the country build infrastructure that's designed to withstand the full range of disasters we've been seeing up to today. Extreme heat, drought, flooding, hurricanes, tornadoes.
Consistent with the president's executive order on tackling the climate crisis at home and abroad, we are issuing a comprehensive environmental justice enforcement strategy. Communities of color, indigenous communities, and low-income communities often bear the brunt of the harm caused by environmental crime, pollution, and climate change.
So, of course, there's no science or data behind any of those claims. They're political slogans. They're completely made up. They're not real. But it's happening anyway. So we're directing natural disaster aid on the basis of skin color.
Decades ago, it used to be one or two a season would happen. Now with climate change and these extreme warm waters, it's almost, you know, it's happening all the time.
This storm, in a way, is kind of bad news for the people that are still trying to deny climate change as a factor.
Florida Republicans deny climate change as a monster storm barrels towards the coast.
This will be a first-time test for how you adapt to these new, stronger storms on a warmer planet as a result of climate change.
The threat exacerbated, of course, by climate change.
Charleston, like Miami, gets water that comes up on a good sunny day. That's climate change because water levels are rising.
Our Earth is getting warmer, and there is just no doubt, I think, left that it is feeding these beasts.
Turns out people keep track of hurricanes. There are lists of hurricanes, so we know there has been no increase in hurricane frequency in the United States from 1900 to 2020, 120 years. In fact, the number of hurricanes has actually declined over the last century. And in that same period, deaths from hurricanes, other natural disasters, have dropped by 90%. 20 years ago, before he died, Michael Crichton delivered a talk in San Francisco about the climate crisis. And he described climate activism in that speech as the religion, not a political movement, a religion for urban atheists, for people who rejected every aspect of Judaism and Christianity. Climate activists had, without saying so out loud, created a religion. All the features you would recognize in any conventional religion. They had their Eden, which would be the world before the settlers arrived. They would have their original sin, because every religion has that. In their case, it would be the Industrial Revolution. And because of that original sin, they believed a rapture was coming, an end of times. And in their telling, the end of times was climate catastrophe. So the only way to save yourself from this rapture, from this end of times, was to renounce your energy sins and embrace climate activism. So Crichton identified this as a sign that religious beliefs are inherent. Everyone has them, even atheists. You may not worship God, but you're going to worship something, and that's true.
Thousands of protesters took to the streets of Oxford to express their opposition to the WEF's 15-minute city agenda. Under the scheme, drivers will have to obtain government passes to travel through certain areas, and if they exceed their ration limit, networks of license plate scanning surveillance cameras will zap them with fines. The council calls it traffic calming. But it looks an awful lot like a de facto climate lockdown and population control.
I could stand here and say more or less what other people are going to say about the effect of these 15-minute neighbourhoods, soon to become digital ID facial recognition zones. Let's say my friend lives in Zone 3 and I'm in Zone 1. If, for example, I went to my friend's house in Zone 3, my parents normally come and pick me up in their car. It only takes 10 minutes. So does that mean that they would have to go round the ring road and back into town again? If my mum or dad had to drive round the ring road, it would take 30 minutes, causing much more pollution and leaving a much bigger carbon footprint. They will say, you can walk home. Would that be safe for me to walk home? Me as a 12-year-old walking home in the dark alone, is that really going to be safe? Then they will say, oh, don't worry about that. We've already thought of that. You'll be safe. We will have 1,000 cameras on the streets following you and tracking you all the way home. Oh, and just remember, it's for your safety.
If it weren't real, it would be funny, hey?
It is true. It is. If you know what? Because people will say, why are you laughing? Because if you know what the Bible is telling you, this is actually laughable.
It's a joke, yes. It's a joke. It's a joke. You know, Martin, perhaps we should feel sorry for these people. In the old days, you had Houdinis, and they were contortionists. In these days, we have these people, and they are distortionists.
Yeah, yeah.
They distort everything. And bottom line, what we're trying to show is that it's a religion.
It's a religion. And it's active, and it's not going away. We've been saying this for 3, 4, 5, 10 years. It's not going away. This will be the glue for the end.
All right. Now, if there's only one true religion, and that's the biblical religion, then by definition, this must be a false religion.
Correct.
And if it is a false religion, would you want to act upon it? Would you like to be sucked into it?
No.
No, I want to watch it like a movie and see how it runs itself against the wall.
It's not that it's not going to affect us.
Oh, it's going to affect us for sure.
For sure. All of this will definitely affect us.
Didn't the test run affect us?
Definitely. You see, so the thing is, we should not get sucked into it because it will affect us. But if we get sucked into it, we're going to get discouraged.
All right. Now, if we know where it's heading, and the Bible tells us where it's heading, then we can make some contingency plans, but there will come a point when we'll be totally reliant upon God.
True.
Now, a few years ago, there was a talk at the United Nations, and Rosalind Peterson addressed the United Nations, and she's actually concerned about climate change and all of these issues, but she also confirms, basically, some of the issues that are contributing it that they deny.
Exactly, they put forward as conspiracy theories.
Correct. So, you know, you have to sift through these things. And when you and I would say something like that, they would say conspiracy theory. But here it is being touted at the United Nations, not as a conspiracy, but as a fact.
Yeah.
So what comes first? The horse or the cart?
We are in a global drumbeat right at the moment, talking about climate change and global warming. One of the things that is affected by climate change is agriculture. But some of what we are seeing is man-made, but man-made in a different way than you may guess. Weather modification programs, experimental ones done by private companies, done by the United States government, done by states across the United States, are underway. There's more than 50 of them in operation across the United States. All of these impact agriculture because they change the microclimates needed for agriculture to survive. none of these programs that I know of today, and this is all public record, are available at any time with oversight, agricultural oversight or public oversight. These programs impact agriculture, and there are programs around the world. International corporations are modifying our weather all the time, and they're modifying it in ways that cover thousands and thousands of square miles. Most of it is chemically altered, so that what happens is that we are putting chemicals, ground-based chemicals that are shot into the air, or chemicals coming from airplanes that change and modify our weather. One of the things that is impacting crop production right now in the United States and reducing photosynthesis and also impacting the ability of solar power panels to generate the type of power that they should is persistent jet contrails. NASA talks about persistent jet contrails as exacerbating global warming because they trap warmth in the atmosphere when they produce cirrus and man-made clouds. NASA also talks about that when we that these aircraft leaving persistent contrails are changing our climate. And when they change our climate to the degree that one jet can leave a persistent jet contrail, which will spread across our sky, which is a trail left by a jet, that trail can expand to 4,000 kilometers and last for 20 hours. This was unheard of in the early 60s and the 70s, and it wasn't until the late 1980s that there was a change and we started to have persistent jet contrails that persist. NASA studies show that part of our global warming problem could be attributed to these types of contrails and the jets that leave them. So one of the issues as we go through is how do you like your skies, natural or man-made? And right now, we are making man-made clouds.
Conspiracy theories, Martin?
Or can we say we told you so?
Let's just leave it at that. Okay. People can make their own conclusions, right? So, Martin, we've come to the conclusion that we are dealing with a religion. Mm. We come to the conclusion that that religion cannot be a true religion.
Yes.
There are too many factors there that tell us that it is a fake religion. Now, we also have a situation in the world where moral values that are encased in the biblical narrative are under attack.
Hugely so, yeah.
So you have cyber attacks, mm-hmm, and you have moral attacks. Now, one of the moral attacks that is really riling up conservative thinking parents or religiously minded parents and people is the gender issue, mm-hmm, which all of a sudden has become a great thing. Again, Hollywood has prepared the way, and Hollywood has introduced this idea in their sitcoms, mm-hmm, in their series that they produce, in their movies that they produce, more and more they snuck it in. And eventually, they didn't only sneak it in, they made it the prominent feature.
That is true.
And every movie that you can imagine must have at least a scene. And then they put it in subliminally into their cartoons, even for children. And you have all of these things, and then they brought it into the schools.
Mm. They used to put it in subliminally in cartoons. Not so anymore.
And then they brought it into the schools. And then they went a step further and they brought drag shows into the schools. And eventually people get so riled up that it can almost lead to a civil war. Mm-hmm. Hmm? Isn't that so?
I think it's not far off.
All right. Now, we are thinking about biblical prophecy, and we always say this. Where is it heading? What is it doing? Is it going to make the pendulum swing to the other side and people say, enough, we're going to reinstate religious values that made this country great in the past? Mm. And obviously we're going down the tube, and that for every country in the world, because the same things have been going on worldwide. So we're going to look at the gender issue. We've done it before. We've insinuated many times. Let's look at some real things that are happening. So here you have an article where parents pull four-year-old from church school for promoting gender identity lessons. Cruel deception. Now, if it was a normal secular school, that would be something that you might expect. But now it's coming into church schools. Mm. And that really gets people upset because they think the church school should be a safe haven.
Look, if you proclaim that you are a church school, then obviously there must be biblical teachings that you follow.
Yes. And if those teachings are pretty straightforward and clear, which they are in scriptures, it takes some theological gymnastics to wrest them from their context and change it around. For example, saying that Paul says, if you burn for one another, then get married. And that marriage, according to them, then would include any gender. Eventually, it might even include other things like marrying your pet.
Yeah, that's actually ridiculous. Like they twist and fiddle with like Romans completely.
Yes, and like that's across the board.
Yeah.
And nobody is... Mm. And when I say nobody, I mean nobody. No religious institution is going to be immune to this kind of attack. So Christian parents in the United Kingdom pulled their four-year-old son from the Church of England school after its head teacher allegedly promoted gender identity lessons. So this is a primary school. It planned to teach young children from a book by Scott Stewart titled My Shadow is Pink, which they felt was inappropriate according to their legal counsel at the London-based Christian Legal Center. Well, the title itself would be disturbing.
True.
So let's say that there is a reason for the concern. And here's another one. National transgender school shooter possibly targeted Christians over hateful rhetoric, Senator says. So now it's becoming a hate crime against Christianity. Now Christians will start getting riled up. Now what if, in a flash, it can go so far that people climb onto the bandwagon, which we said we should first observe before we climb onto a bandwagon, because we want to know where's the bandwagon heading. Mm-hmm. And then we see they're going to go and enforce the moral values as they were, and then inadvertently, without knowing, they actually enforce papal values.
Yes.
And not biblical values. And then a little voice goes up when finally humanity has unified on moral values, and it doesn't stay within Christianity, because I'm sure Islam will climb onto the bandwagon as well. Mm-hmm. And other religions will climb onto the bandwagon as well. And then they will unite on something that is common to them. Let's bring God back into society, whoever that God is and whatever system we're talking about.
Like Rick Warren said, it doesn't matter what makes you do good, as long as you do good.
As long as you do good. How about giving God some more time? How about an enforced day of rest, which they're talking about? And then we will have a loud cry going out against that, which is called the loud cry warning against the mark of the beast. And then you have everybody finally united. Mm-hmm. And here is an irritating voice saying that you are not doing the right thing. You're not working according to the biblical principle. But because all the other religions are involved and they're happy to go along with this, you're going to be the pariah. You're going to be the dog in the story. Mm-hmm. And eventually, instead of the hatred being focused on everything that is wrong, couldn't it just turn against that moral little voice? I'm sure that some of these people that are here being condemned will add their voice and shout down those that bring the loud cry.
Definitely. It's the same, the Jews said, it's better for one man to suffer than for the whole nation. this will be. It's better that this little group suffers.
This irritating little group. It's standing in the way of our moral unity. This is very interesting. So the Nashville school shooting should be investigated as a hate crime since the transgender shooter intentionally targeted Christians. Senator Josh Hawley told Fox News on Tuesday. The Trans Resistance Network, a trans activist group, said the transgender shooter felt no other effective way to be seen than by killing six people at a private Presbyterian school. This is fascinating. The Metropolitan Nashville Police Chief John Drake said Monday night that some believe the shooter held resentment for having to go to that school. Because Christian values are an affront to whatever is contrary to it, yeah. Whatever that is. So Martin, this religious attachment, is it heading in a direction?
It is, and it's so, it's the one of the most sinister ones that Satan is coming up with. Because, like you've just mentioned, the thing is, it is immoral, but the problem is this is going to lead to a wrong outcome.
Okay. Now, it can become so pathetic that they don't want to talk about a woman anymore. They don't want to define a woman or a female. It's now a birthing parent. Mm-hmm. And people are looking at this and they're joking about it because it's so ridiculous that it deserves to be joked about. But there's a serious element in it as well. And I mean, if it goes so far that you even identify as cat and you start putting litter boxes into schools, then, you know, if I were there, I would actually use them just to make everybody clean them up. It's such a ridiculous thing. But again, let's ask the question, Hollywood, did they prefigure it?
Yeah. They know what's coming.
All right. So their prophet, Jesuit Theater, was on the ball. Yeah. And prepared the mindsets, even if it was for a laugh.
That's it. They started off, you must remember, they started it off with a laugh. And then eventually, you mentioned earlier, sitcoms and everything, they started getting more serious with it. Till eventually now, if you are just trying to speak against any of this,
then you are the enemy of the state.
Yeah.
Now, Martin, this was a Monty Python movie. This is years ago because John Cleese is very young here. And let's just look at this little discussion, which here is very tongue-in-cheek. Mm-hmm. But when you look at the reality today, we've moved from a joke to a reality. Isn't that so?
It's true.
Let's look at it. It's very interesting.
I want to be a woman. From now on, I want you all to call me Loretta.
What?
It's my right as a man.
Well, why do you want to be Loretta, Stan?
I want to have babies.
You want to have babies?
It's every man's right to have babies if he wants them.
But you can't have babies!
Don't you oppress me.
I'm not oppressing you, Stan. You haven't got a womb. Where's the fetus going to gestate? You're going to keep it in a box?
Here, I've got an idea. Suppose you agree that he can't actually have babies, not having a womb, which is nobody's fault, not even the Romans, but that he can have the right to have babies.
Good idea, Judith. We shall fight the oppressors for your right to have babies, brother. Sister, sorry. What's the point?
What?
What's the point of fighting for his right to have babies when he can't have babies? It is symbolic of our struggle against oppression.
Symbolic of his struggle against reality.
Well, Martin, perhaps we should give our friend in Australia who sent us that video a little thumbs up. It fits in quite well.
Yeah, no. It's actually ridiculous if you just see how tongue-in-cheek this was, but how it became reality.
Yes, absolutely. All right. So, Martin, let's get back to the serious side of this. Not what is happening, where's it leading? There must at some stage come a pushback.
Yes.
And people must be riled up enough to become involved in order to achieve that pushback. And it's going to be a moral issue. Mm. It's going to be a religious issue. We're going to go back to religious values. We're going to go pendulum swing. Let's see.
Transposing America. That's the focus of tonight's angle. As we just discussed, killer Audrey Hale was living in a sick fantasy world, one that was affirmed and celebrated by modern culture. The fraudulent construct that boys can become girls and girls can become boys. In her twisted mind, her mortal enemies are those who do not affirm her imaginary identity. In this case, her old Christian school and her family. And thus, she goes and blows away six innocent people, including three small children. Now, the knee-jerk political response, very predictable, is to blame the gun culture, urge that AR-15s be banned. But this avoids the undeniable truth that the left has created a world that has our young people on a collision course with reality. Media outlets, which are supposed to be interested in actual facts, are oddly subdued about the prospect of learning more about the killer's motives. Now, we have no idea what was in Ms. Hale's mind, why she targeted the Covenant School, but it is clear that if this is a case of anti-Christian hate, we all should know all about it, including how it was inspired. Unstable people are especially susceptible to poisonous ideology. We already know that some of the left's radical fringe groups are viciously anti-Christian. Now, look at how they attacked churches and pro-life centers over the last few years. And there's a trans day of vengeance planned for this Saturday. Menacing videos are being posted online to promote it. Now, not a peep about this from the DOJ, of course. And this week, Merrick Garland refused to address even a possible hate crimes angle in this Nashville shooting.
Do you plan on opening a hate crime investigation for the targeting of Christians?
The FBI and ATF are both on the scene working with the local police. As of now, motive hasn't been identified.
This is about politics, pure and simple. Now, Democrats have invested a lot in the storyline that white American Christians are the most dangerous people on the face of the planet. Remember, that group, they're the real enemies.
You have these young people who've organized online who call themselves America First. Really, I view that as a slogan, as a way to say we are white nationalists.
Christian nationalists believe the United States was established as an explicitly white Christian nation, and any threat to their agenda must be stamped out, even if that means violence.
You're talking about people who believe in an ethnostate or a religious theocracy.
We are indeed at a tipping point. I know a lot of people say that, but we're at it. We have no time to argue about the obvious or deny basic facts or pretend we're living in a fantasy world where, you know, one sex can become another sex. We can't allow charlatans to divide us. Hard work, family, faith, and patriotism is what will save us. They always have.
Martin, her final words sum up our entire position.
That's exactly. So you can look at all of this and you can, Scott, you can, everything gets riled up in you because of all of this. But then you should listen to what she said last. And this is what our position has been the whole time.
This is our position. Where is it heading? We're going to have a pendulum swing.
So just to make clear, we're not agreeing with what she said in the end. We're just saying that this is going to swing the pendulum because patriotism and all of this is going to lead to the demise of somebody else.
Yes.
And that is what we're saying. This is proving that the pendulum is going to swing.
I'm not going to disagree with you, but I'm going to say that we're not against setting right moral issues.
No, that's the thing. Yeah. So
so even church organizations would say, finally, at last, you know, moral issues are being addressed and humanity is moving in the right direction. But again, let's reiterate, if there is an injection of poison in the moral compass, then it's going to lead to perdition.
Yes.
And there is an injection of poison in the moral compass because it is following changed rules. And the Bible clearly says, here are they that keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony. And those that keep the commandments and have the faith of Jesus.
Yes.
So this will come into clash. So the final clash will be between two religious systems. And the whole world will be involved. Now, who could write so brilliant a script? We're watching a movie, right?
That's for sure.
And we're asking ourselves, who can write so brilliant a script? Only the devil can achieve that. Because even the actors don't know what's going on.
Yes, that's the thing. So most of the people, even the news anchor, is probably sucked in.
Yes.
And is caught up in this. And we agree, it is ludicrous of what all this immorality.
And he's got it covered at every base. He's created over the time this interposition, this Einschub, as I said. He has created all of these religious systems that have been warring against each other for who knows how long. Now he's got them to the point where they are unified and building joint centers and Abrahamic religion and signing documents. And the man in white is very busy. And he's the one running the man in white behind the scenes, Jesuit theater, yeah. Hollywood. And then between all of this, now he's addressing all of these issues. And now you can't say, excuse me, you have to separate from that religion because it's not in harmony with the Bible because you've just got them all together. And if somebody talks against this, they're going to be the enemy. And now you have the moral issue coming right, and somebody wants to say, excuse me, there's something wrong. These people are going to get very riled up.
Yep.
Can you see the time of trouble coming?
It's already on the precipice.
So, Martin, are they already asking for legislation to correct the moral compass?
Yes.
Let's just look at this one. Newsmax, Tennessee House advances bill criminalizing drag shows. We don't have to go into the details of this one. They're already proposing legal action and laws to combat it.
Yes.
It must go in a direction.
It will go in a direction, that's for sure.
So the transgender agenda will shake humanity. It is shaking humanity. I want to predict it's going to shake every single denomination and is already shaking every single denomination. We have to make sure that we know our Bibles, that we know what God wants, and that our life comes into harmony with His will.
For sure.
And there are many sins, not just sins against the seventh commandment. There are 10 commandments, and they're very broad. They cover every aspect of humanity. We have to examine ourselves on every single one of them, whether we are in harmony with God or not. And if there is a transgression in terms of the sixth commandment in your mind, or the eighth, or the ninth, or the tenth commandment, or the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, then we have to get our lives into harmony with God.
Exactly.
Including anything that's wrong in the seventh.
Yes.
Yes. You can't exclude that one and say you were born that way.
No.
No. He created you male and female. So Little Light Studio put together a very interesting one, of which we take a few excerpts and just see what they came up with.
Transgendered bathrooms have come out of nowhere. The next stop on this train is pedophilia. I guarantee it.
Guaranteed. In fact, he guarantees it so much he will commit pedophilia just to make sure that this happens.
I mean, the guy is an absolute moron, a legendary moron. I guarantee you pedophilia is next.
Dr. James Cantor of ChemH, I recall in an interview with the Toronto Star, said, referred to pedophilia as a sexual orientation.
Like every other sexual orientation,
pedophilia can have different characteristics. Anyone could be born a pedophile. We should accept that pedophiles are people who have not chosen their sexuality. We should accept that pedophilia is a sexual preference.
Statistics indicate that there will be one or two of you who are struggling with some form of pedophilic interest. But the problem is, these people can't talk about their feelings because they know that they will be hated for it. However, it doesn't make sense. And that's because we're talking about biology. We're talking about a sexual orientation.
If you want to be a drag queen and your parents don't let you, you need new parents.
Are there children inside?
Yeah, there's three or four of them.
So,
but these girls are all fully clothed. This is a PG performance. Like, it's family friendly.
Actually, one doesn't even want to show it.
No.
But just to make people realize that we're not dealing with figments of the imagination, but with realities. It's a very sick world we're living in. And no wonder God put a limit to the interpolation.
To time.
Which is called time.
Exactly.
Now, just that alone, Martin, doesn't it tell you that time is running out?
Didn't God have to make an end to it once before?
Yes, more than once.
Actually, yes.
More than once. Okay. Now, Martin, if the transgender movement is riling up Christians, don't the Christians need a champion?
Yes, they need the hero that will come and sort this all out.
All right. Now, if I may guess, or why me? Why don't you guess who could that hero be?
Maybe the Pope.
Isn't the wound going to be healed?
Yep.
Isn't the whole world going to wander after him? Mm-hmm. So I wonder what his position would be. What do you think his position would be?
He will be against it. And then sometimes...
Allow it.
Yeah, he speaks some obscure language.
Double talk. Mm. But for the sake of attracting the masses to him...
Yes.
He would have to speak against it, right?
And to swing the pendulum.
To swing the pendulum. Let's see what he says. So, gender ideology is one of the most dangerous ideological colonizations. His comments echo previous statements condemning transgender ideology as a fundamental disorder being forced on the youth. Do you think that'll go down well with the Christians?
Yes, very good.
Okay.
Because now, but it won't go off well with those people that were mentioning it as a sexual orientation.
No, it won't go down well with them at all. He made these comments during an interview with an Argentinian newspaper, and he was asked, why is it dangerous? He continued, because it blurs differences and the value of men and women. All humanity is the tension of differences. It is to grow through the tension of differences, the Pope said. The question of gender is diluting the differences and making the world the same, all dull, all alike, and that is contrary to human vocation. So he's saying the right words, but in the same breath, he speaks well or condones certain actions which are clearly anti-biblical.
Yes.
So without laboring the point, there must be constant media efforts to drive the point, to irritate those that want to take a stand. Mm. And one of them is this UK woman who was arrested for silently praying. She was arrested for what was in her mind, and then she was released, and then she was arrested again. That must rile up the people.
Yeah, I'm sure, especially when you had a judge setting her free.
All right, so the next point is a high school football coach was fired for a prayer that he did. Mm-hmm. And so he went to court and he won the court case.
Yes.
So these are issues that are constantly coming out in the media, reminding people that there is a war against religious values. And people are getting riled up. Isn't that going to make the pendulum swing?
It's starting. It's really all starting. Right.
The next thing you have is sports stars, and there are many of them. Here's one goaltender, James Reimer, who refused to wear a Pride jersey. And they will say, wonderful, and many will be riled up. And they're trying to bring people to climb onto this bandwagon, this train that is picking up speed.
And almost like that other guy said, doesn't have any brakes.
It doesn't have any brakes. Now, do you remember that in the spirit of prophecy, there was this dream of the train that was picking up speed? And that the captain in the front, the conductor,
Satan,
and the one controlling the steam engine was Satan himself. So, Martin, people are beginning to stand up. And they're saying, I'm not going along with this agenda. And they will get followers. And then the pendulum will start swinging. And once that pendulum swings, and a little group stands up and says, we are in accord with your values, but
yes, but
there's a problem. And then you point out the problem, transgression of God's law, following the beast, and his values rather than the moral dictates of God. Here are they that keep the commandments of God, hold to the testimony of Jesus. They will be an irritation. And eventually, all that anger will be swung and directed at that small group.
Yeah.
So, Martin, may God help us as we face this certain future together.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, the world is on an express train to perdition. And help us, Lord, to focus on why you have given the last message of warning in Revelation to people so that they may present it to the world, so that eyes may be opened. Now we know, Lord, that in the loud cry, many will respond. And sadly, many of those will take the place of those that leave the ranks of those that should know better, who have allowed ideologies to infiltrate into their own minds. Please help us to be effective in bringing the last message of warning to the world, and make us part of the loud cry is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.